It's the default Merriam-Webster. Let me write it down. Merriam. It's the most popular dictionary in this country, at least. I think if you're gonna get something, if you get a pocket edition, it's not that expensive. So samples for soliciting orders. See, notice there is a commercial hint here, right? Soliciting orders. So because it has, and again, there is no clear provision. It's not engineering work, right? And this is not a business record, right? A business data. It's just samples. And samples, you don't even know what, samples can be this. This can be a sample. Or this can be a sample. Or, for example, this piece of chocolate can be a sample. So, so there is no, you would not know, but generally speaking, we think of sample as something tangible. And yes, sample is subject to the HTSUS. So, and then articles exported from the US, remember the 45-day rule, and become undeliverable and did not leave the custody. So this is our good old grandma example, which is always out of town or on the other side of town and not to be crisscrossed by the mailman. Again, notice how also the very interesting portion of how customs examiners test you on exception, right? In order for you to really get to the right one, it's easier for you to get it by engaging in the process of elimination. Of course, to eliminate what's not, you must know what's not to get to the truth. So either way, you're required to know the exceptions, and this is a good example of through the multiple choice question where they give you five different answers, customs examiners tested your knowledge on 1, 2, and 3 topics within the exception. Yeah? So I think this is a good question to really see customs methodology with respect to questioning prospective examinees. Okay, so I already talked about the engineering work by pulling it off the HTSUS. Business records, I talked about, for example, chapter 85, business records. For example, you have a flashcard. This is solid state, non-volatile storage device. How many people go to the store and approach the clerk and say, I would like a solid state, non-volatile storage device. Try that at Best Buy. You will see how, you will see the weird reaction of the salesperson. But that's the classification. And is even though it's duty free, the HTS number still applies because it is sold to third parties. All right, this is not it. So those are the major exceptions, right? What about the other exceptions? Well, we again go back to the old, good old informal entry. Under $200, informal, you do not need classification because it is subject to section 19 U.S.C. section 3.1321, I believe. So that's a provision which says less than $200, duty free. So $200 is a benchmark, is duty free. That's another way. If it's duty free, no need to classify it. Because yes, classification is important, but the amount is just too small. So going back to the sample, remember samples going back to this example, when you really start thinking about the question and answer, so see samples for solicit new orders, right? What if the sample is $175? You don't need to classify it, right? The HTS number is not required. But let's take a look at the another one. But really here, what the way you read it is you really remember that there is a best answer rule, right? The best answer rule to answer the questions. In this situation, the best answer, you kind of clearly see this is provided, this is provided, this is provided, this is provided, and this one is nowhere to be seen on the list of exceptions. So you can see the pattern. And this is kind of like a strange statement just standing alone on its own. And because of this, you will pick this one because you are looking for the item's subject, you're looking not for the exception, but you're looking for general rule. And those is like a bunch of exceptions that are bundled together. So that's one way of doing it. Let's go to the example informal. All right. So in informal example, we have a shipment, immediately a buzzword, 175. 175 less than 200. So think section 321 or 19 U.S.C. 1321. And the shipment qualifies for important required under sections 10151, 10152. Hold on a second. Didn't I say section 1321? And all of a sudden we have sections 10151 and 10152. Why didn't I mention them here? Simple. Remember, I talked about legislature, which makes a law. It makes United States code. It's a legislature, Congress. And then customs take this and adopts regulations. Well, sometimes the regulations, the number differ. In this case, the regulations that we have is those. So it will be 19 CFR. 10151, 10152. Yeah? So that reconciles the difference. But is it helpful to know both? Yes, it is, because on the customs exam, customs numbers have referred to this law by Congress, as well as you can see here, to the Code of Federal Regulations sections. So notice the Bill of Lading contains all the except. So you've been tested on an exception. You see the buzzword. And then you go down. Country of origin, shipper name, yes, 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 oops. Harmonized tariff number is not required. Why is it not required? Because it is less than $200. All right. So, let's have a 5 to 10 minute break and we shall resume. So, other provision to which customs for some weird reason, weird to me because as you shall see later, both count. They have on the customs broker exam questions, they tend to ask examinees, is it legally binding or not legally binding? So you have things which are legally binding and not legally binding. And I always find this kind of really weird dichotomy because you have to be aware of both. But at the same time, one has a legal weight, one has not legal weight. And how do you reconcile this? Well, for example, we've done a question, right, where we had a situation where statistical suffix, if incorrectly put, customs import specialist can reject it. Remember, we had that question at the beginning? All right. If it's not legally binding, why? What's the reason for customs to reject it? Well, because it doesn't conform to the statistical requirements. But statistical requirements are put in HTS. They are mandated by customs. So in a way, statistical requirement is kind of legally mandated provision which is required to be reported to customs. Nonetheless, I have to cover this because customs did focus on this, not on one exam, but on several exams, and there is no reason for me not to say that it will not happen again. So let's talk about it. So there are provisions that are legally binding as well as not legally binding. And not legally binding provisions include provisions which are merely statistical. Also include provisions what they call for reference. So at the end of the HTS harmonized tariff schedule, let's go back to our HTS outline. We have alphabetical index. It will be at the very end of your harmonized tariff schedule book, and it will look like this. It will spell out the various things. So let me increase it a little. So, for example, it starts with A, and it just lists commodities by the general names. So you have group for air pumps, and they say, okay, if you classify air pumps, it's a good idea for you to start looking at this provision of the harm. So chapter 84, 14 heading, 20 subheading. So it's helpful to you to start here looking here. Aircraft, chapter 88. Aircraft engines, they refer you to also chapter 84. Notice, aircraft is in one provision, engines are in completely different chapter, right? So is this legal? So can an aircraft engine be by any weird reason classifiable here as like a part of airplane? Well, in this example, I'm not sure, right? But this whole alphabetical index, this alphabetical index is really about the ease of reference. It's for reference purposes. It's not legal. It's just there to help you out. That's all. So because it's there to help you out, it's not legal, it's not legally binding. That would be an example. Now, going back to the outline, let's look at the various things which are legally binding versus not legally binding. So we have change of record. What's change of record? I had almost every semester a student comes to me, says, Yuri, can I use the old HTSUS version, or can I use old TFR version? And I say, well, it depends on the chances you like to take based on the probability of changes. Sometimes from year to year, a harmonized tariff schedule changes a lot. Sometimes it doesn't change at all. So how do I know to say, no, there won't many changes, don't worry about it? Or no, because of the several trade agreements that came through, harmonized tariff schedule increased substantially, plus World Customs Organization meeting came through, and they adopted a whole new provisions for the whole new products. There was in the mid-2000s, for example, you used to classify monitors, like for the computers, in chapter 84. But if it wasn't for the computer, you would classify it in chapter 85. So there was this weird type of situation which was resolved, where they adopted a special provision for monitors even if it's for the computer in chapter 85, for example. So change of record is helpful, but it's not legally binding in the sense where it just documents the history of change. Let's take a look at one. So change of record would be here. So you have a cover and you have a change of record, and this is what it looks like. It's just a bunch of stuff which take place. So you see general node has been some parts has been deleted. Some parts have been, some free trade agreements have been deleted, right? So APTA, Andean Preference Trade Agreement, I believe, is no longer relevant because it is outdated. And because it is outdated, it's gone, right? And you go down, you have replacements, general, and this is general nodes, modifications,